You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Today, this breakfast isn't just breakfast. It might be the first McDonald's breakfast you're having at McDonald's again. This lunch might be a weekly tradition you hadn't had in weeks. And this dinner might be the first one you bought for not just you in a while. Whatever this order is for you, McDonald's will be here to take it.
Get more of the chicken you love with a delicious McChicken sandwich for $1. And for an extra buck, add a refreshing Dr. Pepper. Dining rooms are starting to reopen in certain communities at participating McDonald's. Cannot be combined with any other offer or combo meal.
In uncertain times, we could use someone to lean on. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma will stand by you with plan options to fit your budget. If you've recently lost your job, had a baby, or moved, you can still get the health care coverage you and your family need. Financial help may be available for those who qualify. Call 855-452-BLUE or visit hereforyouok.com to see if you're eligible to enroll. Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Oklahoma, a division of Healthcare Service Corporation, a mutual legal reserve company.
Not to be a backseat driver, but can you say for sure you got the best monthly payment possible on your auto loan? Could it be that you might have gotten a better deal by shopping the loan at a few places and have a lower car payment? Next time, before you go car shopping, visit Communication Federal Credit Union first. Our auto loan experts will find you a perfect loan and get you the lowest monthly payment we can. Communication Federal, your auto loan experts. Restrictions apply. Federally insured by NCUA.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
A new year means it's time for a new home network that can keep up. With Cox Internet, you have the speed and coverage your family needs to stay connected. You'll enjoy Cox's fiber-based hybrid network with options for fast upload and download speeds. And if your household has lots of connected devices, panoramic Wi-Fi may be the perfect fit thanks to its additional control features. Plus, with advanced security on panoramic Wi-Fi, you'll know each connected device is securely protected 24/7. A whole world of connectivity is yours with Cox Internet. Learn more at cox.com.
It's Sunday night. Let's get started.
Run.
If you find yourself lurking about the internet on a Sunday night and it's about 9:04 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, which, as we all know, is the only time that actually matters, and you find yourself dropping in on Sunday night with Alan Ray, which I am Alan Ray. Welcome. Get in that chat room, www.klrnradio.com/chat. Where you will find miscreants and mayhem makers like Ordy Packard. We got Jeff. We got JC in there. We got Rex in there. We got Big Mike in there. We got Raptor in there. Who else do we have in there? Who is that dropping? Oh, boy. Who is that? There's somebody else in there. Don't know who they are. Identify yourself. Intruder alert. No, everybody's welcome here. Even if I don't get who you are right off the bat. Welcome to Sunday Night with Alan Ray. I am your humble host. A lot of stuff to talk about tonight, because there's a lot of things going on. It feels like it's been a month since we last spoke, even though Jeff and I were on last week dissecting the whole balloon incident thing. God, it seems like a lifetime ago. So let's get this going.
Feed 'em up, Frankenstein.
You know, balloons. We were, Jeff and I were pretty close to being correct on that one. Ended up being somebody's science experiment. Sorry to interrupt you, Alice. Down your house, and then I'm gonna eat ya. Bring you to a simmer. Oh, yeah, you gotta love that. Don't want to interrupt Alice Cooper in the midst of a performance. Sorry, sir. My gosh, that's some headbanging stuff right there. Can't get over it. Anyways, the outside of the Chinese spy balloon, which they shot down, and we've figured out that, yes, it was, in essence, it was actually spying on us. And there's some reports out there that say it actually may have, could have, I don't believe anything until I see solid proof, might have had explosives in it that would keep us from getting anything off of it. Must not have worked, but we recovered some of it. We know there was a nice, big, high-def camera on it and all that. It was only flying over some of our inland nuclear bases. It was only collecting a bunch of data. Oh, that's all. And so then the dunderheads that are running this nation right now, the Biden administration, they go out and anything that's flying that is not on their radar, they just shoot down because they got to play heroes. We were right about that. They got to play. And we were also right that, yes, they did come from probably America. But the thing that we the funniest part about it is it's starting to look more and more like at least the balloon or whatever it was in Alaska was a science project. And people are out there. I mean, they do this stuff all the time. They launch balloons with little Raspberry Pi computers on them being, you know, with battery power. They track them. They do weather reports. They do things like that. And congratulations. We spent how many millions of dollars of a air-to-air missile, and we shot down a $12 balloon. Congratulations. So now we're going to overreact because we feel embarrassed because we got caught allowing the Chinese to fly a legitimate spy balloon across the entire United States. So now we're just going to shoot down a whole bunch of stuff so we look good, look like heroes. What a bunch of idiots. And we jump from that right into train crashes. Yes, a whole week full of train derailments, which is where I want to start off today. And indulge me for just a little bit here, because what is going on in Palestine, Ohio, Palestine, Palestine, that's Palestine. I think that's how they prefer you. There's so much, there's like a swirl of speculation and rumor and just all kinds of things going on there. We really, unless you're from there, and you feel like calling in on this show, which we do have one of our listeners actually is close. And there are a lot of people around the area are saying it doesn't appear to be as bad, as devastating as what some of the media is saying. But there's other people out there that are saying there's weird things happening here. You know, we got dead fish. We got things going on. Who do you believe? Well, Tucker Carlson actually had a family on there that said that these people showed up at their house and they said they were from a third party, you know, didn't have anything to do with the government, nothing to do with the railroad. But what they wanted them to do before they checked their air, their water and their soil was sign this little contract. And that contract basically said that these people were not going to hold the government or Norfolk Southern or the EPA or anybody legally responsible for what could go on. Yeah, no, you're not going to sign that. Please, God, tell me nobody signed that stupid paper. Please tell me that everybody just took that contract and shoved it right back into the chest of these people and said, no, go do your job and check this stuff out. I want to report. So what we need to do is, first of all, you got to understand, what we're witnessing down there, of course, you know, and then there was immediately two derailments on the exact same railroad track that runs behind my house. How unsettling is that? Even though it was like 50 miles down the track in Detroit, just outside of the Detroit area, it's still right behind my house. Now, I know for a fact they haul some pretty sketchy stuff on that rail line. I mean, I see some of these tankers go through and I go, oh, boy. You know, I see them up close and personal. You've heard it on the podcast. If you listen to this show over and over, you know that every once in a while the train just goes right through the podcast. It's literally probably 200 yards outside my back window. That's how close it is. And in fact, it just went through right before we started the show. But it's the whole thing to me, I worry, okay? I would like to think that maybe, hopefully, that what they did when they burned off the chemicals so they could move these rail cars and stuff wasn't as stupid and boneheaded as some people are making it out to be. I have my doubts. The reason I have my doubts is because in the 70s, something happened to me, all my close friends, the entire town which I grew up in. In the 70s, and, you know, I can't really pinpoint the exact date, the exact year, but it's out there. You have to fight to even find any mention of it, but we all know it. We all seen it. I remember being pulled out of school one day. Almost a panic. It was the principal came over, the announcement said, go to your buses immediately. We're sending you home. They sent us home that day because the portions of my hometown were being evacuated from a bromine leak. Well, unfortunately, in their infinite wisdom, they sent all of us children from the school that I was going to right through the cloud of bromine. Right through it. Which was bad enough as it was. Now, they came across the air and the local radio station, everything. They said, now, this is not, you know, not going to hurt you. It's okay. It's going to smell a little funny, but you're going to be fine. A couple of years go by, and suddenly a lot of kids especially, right around the area of that bromine plant, started developing strange cancers. Some of them died. Some of them lived for quite a while, but not very long lives. A lot of them developed all kinds of health issues, asthma, and just all kinds of weird issues. Now, you have to understand, my hometown has quite a few chemical plants in it. Just recently, less than 10 years ago, another bromine leak happened. My point is this. I watched friends die. And as much as they tried to pin it on this factory, the factory, who had great teams of lawyers, must have had some kind of inside to either the state or federal government. Basically, their whole attitude was, prove it. You can't. Never paid a dime in reparations for anybody. Never helped any of the people they made sick. Although, as years go by, and of course this place is gone now, it's replaced by a new bromine company, which is further in town, which is stupid. Somebody, some nerd in one of the colleges, did a cancer cluster research, and it all pinned right in the middle of where that bromine leak was. Now, this leads me back to Palestine, Ohio. You are not really going to know the amount or if there is any kind of devastation for a few years. Yeah, you might get some right away. You might get some people with some, I don't know, respiratory illnesses, some diseases, something like that. But I am willing to put this out there that I am going to assume that you are not going to really see issues for 2 to 5 years, maybe even 10. And by the time these issues surface, by the time these issues break, So much time will pass that Norfolk Southern, with the help of the United States federal government, the Environmental Protection Agency, and all the rest of the bureaucracy and muckety-mucks that are in Norfolk Southern's pocket, which predominantly owners, from what I hear, are BlackRock and a couple of the other multi-billionaire stockholders. By the time the effects of this, if they're going to happen, by the time the effects of this happen, it's going to be so far removed from the actual incident, all they have to do is say, prove it. Prove it. You can't. You cannot. And you're right, JC, bromine is no joke. What I understand from this is that there was two agents released during the burn-off, or during the, well, I guess during the burn-off. One of the agents was actually used as a gas in World War I. You know, back in the times where they didn't really care that, you know, they were destroying the planet when they were releasing mustard gases and stuff like that. They're both toxic. They're both hazardous. They both could have long-term effects. And it makes me wonder. It makes me wonder. I feel bad for the people in the area. And I watched these, this picture of local authorities drinking water out of the tap. Drink it down, suck it down. Yeah. Okay. That's one drink. Live in it. Live in it. Live in the area for the rest of your life. When your hair starts falling out, your teeth falling out, come see me. I worry about it. I worry about it. I pray I'm wrong. I really hope I'm wrong. But I've watched way too many friends develop really odd diseases and cancers and things because of the same type of attitude that something happens and nobody takes it seriously. And it's hard. You have to understand, it's really hard to basically rise up against a railroad. They have way too much power. The power that railroads have go all the way back to when America was young and we were pushing westward. And they needed all kinds of permission to do things that might have been just a little bit unsavory in regular times. If you ever want to fall down a rabbit hole, just go on. Don't go on Google, because Google is going to take the side of whatever narrative is. Go on a reputable search engine. And type powers of the railroad companies. You will be amazed. You'll be stunned. And here comes another train. Apparently, whatever happened to Detroit, there was two of them. One of them was just Saturday. Whatever happened must be cleaned up, because trains have been going by here all day. And one's coming in right now. And this is the exact same rail. This is the exact same line that goes all the way up into Wayne County and where both of these derailments happened. So must have been at a switch or something. Now, I have been listening to, I'm the nerd, okay? I'm the nerd. I have an old scanner, and I've brought this up on my show before. I've got an old Bearcat scanner. In the day, it was like top end. Of course, police and fire departments, ambulances, they don't use regular frequencies anymore. They use what they call trunking frequencies, which are a band of frequencies that scan back and forth, and they're digitized and everything. And to get one of those scanners nowadays cost about $500-$600. I'm not going to spend that much. What I do have is I've got this old Bearcat scanner, and there's still a lot of things you can plug into this and listen to. One of them, which is Norfolk Southern's rail, which runs right behind my house. I get it great. It's 160.380. I know that off the top of my head. A lot of my radios are tuned into it, because I could turn it on right now and I can tell you it's going to go by, and there's going to be a digital voice comes on and says Norfolk Southern milepost 5.5, no defects. What that means is it's reached a certain milepost. It's all the sensors on the train are functioning normally. I've heard it one time in my life, I've heard it say defect rail 10 and something else. And I went, oh, wait, what? I almost couldn't believe it. But what I'm saying is, these people are out there, the federal government, the EPA, probably the local government, the federal government especially, and Norfolk Southern and all their teams of lawyers are out there protecting their butts. They're out there doing everything they can to make sure that this doesn't come back on them in the long run. My advice to the people in that area, if this somehow gets out there, don't sign anything. Don't sign a thing. And if you do, go find a lawyer that you can actually trust, if there is such a thing. Give it to them and say, what does this actually say? What am I signing here? You'd be surprised. Because I get the feeling that they're trying to make it where, well, just like Pfizer and Moderna, these mRNA vaccines, where you can't do anything about it if it ends up killing a bunch of people. And that's a dangerous game. The government's playing a very dangerous and stupid game when they do stuff like this. Because what happens if we find out that Pfizer and Moderna are, and there's unequivocal proof that they are toxic and people are dying, and it comes to the point where they're backed into a corner and they can't do anything except say, yes, it does, confirm it, and apologize. Well, we can't prosecute them. We can't legally do anything to them. So what does that do? That leaves their fate in the hands of very pissed off people is what that does. That could be bad. That could be tragic. That could mean a lot of people coming up, being dragged through streets that may be innocent bystanders. We've reached a point in this nation. It's almost like we've reverted. We've gone left so hard. And I know they're going to sit there and go, well, these are right-wing policies. They're not. They're not. They're really not. All the people that own this stuff, all the people that are running this country right now, all the people that are running the schools, the institutions, the banks, the government, they're all left. They're all left-wing. We are literally being run by left-wing extremists. But yet they still point to the right and say, well, it's all their fault. It's not. It's not. We don't run anything anymore. We haven't been running anything. Trump was an anomaly. And even when we did have control of the House, the Senate, and the presidency, we had so many establishment Republicans who basically are Democrats fighting so hard not to go back, restore the Constitution, restore our freedoms, that we couldn't get anything done. That's where we're living right now. But you got to understand that these left-wing morons are going to stand up. They're going to stand up for their side. And if Biden starts getting implicated, Kamala Harris out there, cackling Kamala out there, if she starts getting implicated and saying, look, these guys have been covering this stuff up. There's something nefarious going on here. We want to know what it is. They're going to come to their defense. Oh, and by the way, all the lawyers are left-wing. Very rarely will you get a right-wing lawyer. They're out there. I know they are. There's a couple of them on Twitter that I'm friends with. They're the minority, major minority. It's almost impossible. We're fighting a losing battle. Now, let's take Palestine, Ohio, and set it aside. You know, let's put it in perspective. Let's just take that whole scene and let's just put it over here in this notch. Let's take the two train derailments in the Detroit area, put those in that notch. Let's take the Chinese spy balloon, put it in this notch, and the other three or four, however many balloons that we went after and shot down, whatever, put them in that notch there. You're starting to see this puzzle form. There is a whole lot of stuff going on. Do I add the shooting at Michigan State University in with that? I don't know. I'm not ready to. Michigan State University was the direct result of a progressive judge not prosecuting a violent criminal, a known federal lawbreaker, not prosecuting him because of his skin color. That judge is 100% responsible for the deaths of those MSU students. She should be tried and convicted and put below the prison along, well, you can't put the shooter along because he killed himself. But you can fill in the blanks. You take all that stuff. You take all the little laser lights. You feel like a cat. Ooh, look here. Ooh, look there. Ooh, look here. Look there. You know, you're like a cat chasing a little green laser across the floor. And suddenly you wake up and you think, there is a lot of stuff going on. When a lot of stuff like this goes on, usually means the government's up to something that they don't want you to think about. What? And yes, gentlemen, that was a train going through. I told you, One went through right before the show. One went through just now. When gas prices are high, when the economy sucks, when everything is going downhill, train traffic increases exponentially. When I first moved out here, you might get 4 or 5 trains a day. Now you might get 2 an hour. You're right, Mike. It does come through about the same time, 9:22. Yeah, I didn't think about that, but you're right. But anyway, we have all this stuff going on. And we got the media stirring up, whipping up a bunch of frothy mouth idiots. So it's time to take a step back and go, okay, what are they distracting us from? Well, we know. Anybody that has a brain already knows. One of the biggest things is we are suspecting that the Joe Biden administration are actually the ones that blew up the Nord Stream pipeline. In fact, there's more and more proof coming out. That's scary. That little mistake, that little stupidity alone, could drag us into an all-out World War III. And here's the problem. Okay. It didn't just screw up Russia. It screwed Germany. It screwed a whole bunch of European nations. Now, what's going to happen if all of a sudden all of them stop and go, you know, that was kind of bogus. We got people freezing here and Biden administration blew up the pipeline. What happens if all these people pool together and look at America and, you know, we've had about enough of your crap. What are we going to do? What are we going to do if they decide to impose the same sanctions on us as they did on Russia? What are we going to do if they actually decide to attack us? Say, you know, we've had about enough of you. We're going to bring you down. See, that's the problem. The people don't start wars. Governments start wars. Here in 2023, what do you have to start a war about? You have nothing to start a war about. What do you want to do? You want to go to get up in the morning. You want to go to work, make a decent living, be able to play, pay your bills. Come home at night, turn the TV on or turn your radio on or read a book or play a game, whatever. Enjoy your family, kiss your wife and kids goodnight and put them all to bed and maybe have a stiff drink and go to bed yourself. That's what the American people want to do. That's what the Russian people want to do. It's what the Iranian people want to do. Maybe not all of that, but some of it. The governments just can't leave well enough alone. It's not the people that are the problem. It's the governments. It always has been. It always has been from day one. The whole goal, you think about it, the whole goal of most governments is to get people whipped up into frothy mouth screaming rages against an unknown boogeyman. For years, you know, Russia, Russia, Russia. We're hearing it again. Russia, Russia, Russia. They did this. They did that. Oh, they swayed the election. No, they really didn't. The Democrats actually swayed the election. Twitter swayed the election. We actually have receipts. No, it was Russia. Russia, Russia bots. Russian troll bots. They did it. Yep, 100%. Well, we even brought the receipts. We had them before Congress. We had the old Twitter regime before Congress. And they had the receipts there going, look, you guys did this. This is you. I don't know why they had the old Twitter regime. They should have had the FBI, the heads of the FBI sitting before Congress going, this was you. You quite literally rigged the election. They should have Adam Schiff. And who's that other senator? I forget which other senator. He had a whole list of people on Facebook and Twitter. Well, these are Russian bots. Not a single one of them are Russian bots. Have them before Congress going, what are you doing? You practically denied these people their free speech. Congratulations. Now you're going to prison. We live in interesting times. And here's the thing. We know that Biden had the, I don't know, what would you say? Biden had the desire to do something to that Nord Stream pipeline. How do we know that? Because all the way back in February of 2020, he said it. Biden said, if Russia invades, and this is us from, this is from actually Fox News. Let's view the original. I got it in my pocket app, but I want to look at it as it came in. I did a little bit of research on this and found it, and I was like, huh, how come this isn't front page news? Well, I'll tell you why it's not front page news in a minute. But Joe Biden himself said that if Russia invades Ukraine, he's going to do some things. If Russia invades, that means tanks and troops crossing the border of Ukraine again. There will be no longer a Nord Stream 2. We will bring it to an end. That is a direct quote from the President of the United States of America. Let me reread that to you. If Russia invades, that means tanks and troops crossing the border of Ukraine again, then there will no longer be a Nord Stream 2. We will bring it to an end. And when asked how, Biden said, we will. I promise you, we will be able to do that. All right. That was published by Fox News February 8th, 2022. And he said that right at the beginning of all this. And now they're asking you not to believe that the Biden administration had something to do with the Nord Stream explosion. Well, you got a Pulitzer Prize winner out there, Seymour Hersh. Claims that the U.S. Navy was behind the Nord Stream 2 pipeline explosion. And this broke on the 8th, the same time the other one. It says Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Seymour Hersh has alleged U.S. Navy divers laid bombs that destroyed the Nord Stream 2 natural gas pipeline under the Baltic Sea last September, drawing a denial from the Pentagon on Wednesday. And this is from New York Post. Hersh, who scooped journalism's top award more than 5 decades ago for exposing the My Lai massacre of Vietnamese civilians by U.S. troops in 1968, cited an unnamed source, which I really wish to God they would just go ahead and cite the sources, in reporting on Substack that Americans planted remotely triggered explosives that wrecked 3 of the 4 pipelines built to carry natural gas from Russia to Europe. Hersh is now 85. He went on to claim that the Navy conducted the operation under the cover of a NATO maritime exercise, Baltops 22. That's Baltops, not Balltops 22. Get your mind out of the gutter, guys, in chat. I just know you're going to get this one. In a short statement, the Pentagon, of course, denied it. The United States was not involved in the Nord Stream explosion. Right. Okay, sure. I'm sure you weren't involved in setting in Vietnam in order and all this stuff. So we don't believe the government. That's the problem. We don't believe you. So if this is all true, this is probably one of the big things that we are being distracted away from. Because if everybody stopped and went, now, wait a minute, we did that. America did that. We are freezing the people out in Germany. That's not right. Why are we being the aggressor here? So, of course, they're going to lie to you. Why wouldn't they? We have already reached the bottom of the hour. I can't believe it. When we come back, we got a whole bunch of other stuff to do. Whole bunch of other rabbit holes to go down, including one that I just find absolutely hysterical. Don't go anywhere. I'll be back in just a moment.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. you'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now, 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Attention business owners and independent contractors. This is a money-saving message from Tax Mediation Services. If your business owes $20,000 or more in taxes, we can help you today, right now. Listen, dealing with the IRS is no picnic. It's an intimidating and extremely stressful process, and you don't want to go it alone. Our attorneys know every law, every tax break, and every possible opportunity to help you resolve and reduce your tax debt. And if you owe more than $20,000, you may be at the top of their hit list. So don't take your tax debt lightly, because it will not go away on its own. The IRS can seize your bank accounts, your home, and even shut down your business. Call our tax experts today at 1-800-783-0810 and let us deal with the IRS while you focus on your business. That's 1-800-783-0810. Again, that's 800-783-0810.
Okay, everything I said in the first half hour, I was just kidding, okay? Everybody knows that Joe Biden's going to get us into World War III. How can they actually cover that up? We all know it. We all know it. I really think this, and then this is my tinfoil hat coming on, okay? What I really think they're trying to cover up is the fact that South Park this week came out with a new episode that absolutely roasts, I mean, catches on fire, up 20 feet tall flames that you couldn't stomp out with giant boots, roasts Meghan Markle and Prince Harry.
Hey, thanks for having us on the show.
It's so awesome to be here. It's great.
Now, I've watched this. And I've also went down the rabbit hole just before my show tonight of watching a lot of British news sources report on the Americans and their South Park episodes roasting Meghan Markle and Prince Harry. And they love it. They love it. I mean, come on. These are the people. These are the people that, you know, have things like Monty Python, who would roast any royalty just for the kicks. I mean, Blackadder, all of the British comedies. It's just a thing to roast royalty. That's just what they do. And just about every YouTube video I saw of a reaction of the Brits to this South Park episode, they're screaming with laughter. They're screaming with laughter. They think it's absolutely hysterical. In fact, this really might just solidify the relationship between the British people and the American people overall, because we can all solidify, we can all pool together with one thing. That Meghan Markle and Prince Harry are just absolute idiots. But in response, according to GBN News, Meghan Markle and Prince Harry lawyers are casting an eye over South Park's latest series after the show launched a number of attacks on the couple. Oh, these are attacks. Attacks. South Park has taken multiple shots at Meghan Markle and Prince Harry, mocking their claims that they want privacy despite signing lucrative deals with Netflix and Spotify to publish content about their lives. Prince Harry's autobiography, Spare, which has been ridiculed with South Park referring it to as wah. The series has also branded the couple dumb and stupid, which, okay, whatever. Royal commentator Neil Sean has stated the couple's legal team is now watching the series closely for any more attacks. Sean said, according to sources close to the ex-royals, it appears that, like so many things with Meghan and Harry, this may have legal ramifications attached. Their legal teams are casting an eye over the episode to see what is wrong and what can be turned into something more sinister. However, Fox News have stated that it has not been confirmed whether legal action will be taken or not. Meghan and Prince Harry's popularity in the U.S. has drastically fallen since they attacked the royal family, according to the chairman of Republican Overseas UK. Greg Swenson told GB News that the fondness of some media outlets for the Sussexes are not shared by the American public. No, they're not. No. Here's, let's just put it all in a nutshell. We fought a bloody war, so we don't have to bow down to royalty. I think, personally, South Park nailed it. They nailed it. I mean, they just put it up there against the wall and they drove a 10-foot spike right through it. They nailed their personalities. They nailed everything about them. They nailed the fact that through the whole episode, Meghan and Harry are walking around with signs going, "We want privacy. We want privacy." They're glory hounds. That's what they are. So I'm pretty sure that the whole balloon episode things, the whole train derailments, all this stuff is to get you to not watch that South Park episode. That's what we're hiding here, guys. That's all a conspiracy that Prince Harry and Meghan Markle all went to the government and contrived all of these things so that you would not watch this South Park episode. That's it. That's a conspiracy. Show's over. We're done. That's it.
Doom!
I'm just kidding. I really hope to God that the creators of South Park do something predictable, at least in South Park world, and just make a second episode that just totally flies in the face, where they actually just go into South Park and try to sue somebody for making fun of them. Double down. Guys from South Park, oh God, I love you all. Double down. Go after them for a second one. We'll even start a GoFundMe. We'll help your legal fees. For God's sakes, go after them again. That was just too funny. And they nailed it. They nailed it. It was just great. I mean, and that's the thing about South Park, okay? I grew up with Mad Magazine. A lot of people in chat right now grew up with Mad Magazine. Chat, tell me, was there anybody sacred to Mad Magazine? Was there anybody that they didn't jump on and ride right into the ground in one of their magazines? Name me one person that they stayed away from. I defy you to try. I was a long time ago. I read an article where they asked them flat out, how many lawsuits have you had? And the guy says, we don't even pay attention to them anymore. We just got lawyers that go in there and say, look, just deal with it. Yeah, Rex, you're absolutely right. Mad was a must. Up until the day, well, they still publish some, I don't know, once in a while they'll throw a new magazine out there. And you got to get it. You got to buy it. It's the best social commentary we got going. And to tell you the truth, South Park has kind of taken Mad Magazine's place in 2023. You know, Mad doesn't have the energy that they used to have behind them. It used to be that there was just so much going on in a Mad Magazine, and the artwork and all of that. I mean, you could read it like 20 times and still not suck all of the parody and all of the roasting out of it. But I can tell you right now that South Park and the way they do their animation, they can get things out so quickly because of the way they do their animation. It's very quick animation. It's very cheesy. It's very cheap. But by God, it's just dead on every time. This was the second episode, JC. Okay, I've lost track of a lot of it. I'm gonna have to get Anthony back on the show so he can talk about it. According to JC, that was the second episode. The first one was the marriage episode. At the end, Harry ripped off Meghan's arm at the altar and pegged himself with it as its tradition. Oh my gosh! So do a third one, guys. Do a third one, please. I beg you. So yeah, I'm pretty sure that everything that we talked about first half hour was created to cover up what was about to drop with the South Park episode, because they knew it was going to be bad. They knew it was going to really roast them. Oh, let's face it. Meghan and Harry, they're whores. They're whores. They're media whores. They want so badly for you to watch everything they do and then cry victim. I mean, they embody, they epitomize that age group in this day and age. And it's sad to see. It's really sad to see. Because Prince Harry, I mean, he started out really on the right track. I mean, the guy went, you know, into the military. He did all these things. He proved himself. Only to have his cojones cut off by this third-rate actress. Oh. He'll grow up someday and he'll live to regret it. I swear to God he will. And then the big thing is they're asking, why is their popularity waning in the United States? I ask you this. When did they have popularity in the United States? The only people that really paid attention to them was the press. Yeah, there's a few people that follow royalty, and I don't care if you do or not. I'm not here to argue that or not. But I would say a good 80% of their, quote, popularity, unquote, was the press fawning over them. Nobody else cared. Nobody cared. We still don't. A lot of us don't care. I mean, we look at them for what they are. Now, one of the British reporters, and I don't know which man, she had a good take on it. And it wasn't a silly take. It wasn't a hilarious take. She said, in a way, you know, she goes, number one, I'm gonna tell you flat out, the South Park episode was hilarious because I roared through the whole thing. But number two, you also have to realize this is a damaged couple. It is a damaged couple. I don't know what Harry's personal life was like. I don't know what Meghan's personal life was like. But I can tell you one thing. If all else fails, this goes to show you that wealth and fame do not make you successful. As far as I'm concerned, Meghan and Harry, they're just failures. They're flops. You look at them, the only thing they can serve as is examples of how not to act and be if you achieve some sort of popularity. Don't be media whores. Yep, and there you have it. This is exactly why. This is exactly why all this stuff is going on right now, to cover up that South Park episode. It's not supposed to have been released. That's it. That's my conspiracy theory. Everybody put your tinfoil hats on. And you're right, Mike. Spy versus Spy in Mad Magazine, that was the best. What other things are going on? You know, I tried to get to this. I was going to get to this last week. But Jeff and I, you know, Jeff from Lost Wanderer came on the show. We got sidetracked. We did a whole hour on the whole balloon thing. And by God, like I said, you know, for just off the cuff, I think we were more accurate in our assessment of everything going on than most of the media. I'm feeling pretty good about that. But what I wanted to get to is this. This is a ham radio thing, but it's kind of cool even outside of the ham radio world. There was an expedition that went to Bobe Island. Ham radio operators. Now, if you don't know who or what or where Bobe Island is, Bobe Island is like almost to the South Pole. Bobe Island is this very remote, one of the most remote islands. It's so remote, it's like, what, 1,700 kilometers, which is 1,100 miles, north of the Princess Astrid coast of Queen Maud Land, Antarctica. It's very, very remote, very, very desolate. And the weather there is absolutely horrible. Norway has something to do with it. Norway is somehow like claimed this island, which I don't know what that even means, because it's just this iceberg floating around. No, it's an actual island, but it's just covered in ice. So what these ham radio operators did is they were going to go to Bove Island. They're going to set up and they were going to try to make as many contacts as they can. Things went south really quick for them. As they were approaching the island, weather was good. Everything looked good. The closer they got to the island, things went south. I mean, they lost a bunch of equipment. They ended up having just a little bit of the equipment they came with. One of the nights they literally had to, and this is here's the prepper thing again. They literally had to sleep under a tarp, a tent tarp, because they couldn't get the regular equipment on to the shore because of swells and everything. So they got a couple of the people and they got some of the stuff on there just enough to keep them from dying. And then they got everything else on there. They ended up only being able to run a 100 watt, basically barefoot, what we call barefoot in the ham radio world, operation for a few days. And then their generator even went out. I mean, the thing was just doomed. Now, I'm watching videos, watching things, watching like the ham radio community just basically complain like crazy about this. This was just a scam. This is that. Not everything can be successful, guys. This was not successful. They did make a few contacts. There was some people that I know that I've heard that said they did some FT8, which is like digital QSOs. There were some people that actually were able to contact them. It was really rough for them. I mean, all kudos to these guys. If you've seen the pictures of Bove Island, you see the pictures of their camp. They couldn't even get cots in their tent. They had to sleep on the floor of the tent, which you're basically sleeping on a bed of ice. They had very little heat. It had to have just been miserable. They did make some contact, so I guess it was kind of successful. But if you're looking at the pictures I'm looking at, more power to you, gents. I wouldn't want to do it. I wouldn't want to do it at all. So all of you naysayers out there, all you people out there, special people that are out there complaining about this, that this was a scam, this was a setup, they didn't do what they said they were going to do, you have to understand that they gave it a good go. They gave it a try. Just wasn't in the stars. And now if you're any kind of ham radio operator, you know that lately especially, everything has been going up and down. Sometimes the radio waves, sometimes propagation is absolutely beautiful. I've had a couple of different, last Saturday and this Saturday, I've made some really good contacts just on my little 100 watt rig, my little, in-fed wire going across the backyard. Excellent contacts, Oklahoma, North Carolina, South Carolina, Florida, just all over up into Canada. And you go down there in the middle of no man's land and things go fall apart and you're only running 100 watts. There's not a lot of choices you have. There's not a lot of things you can do. They did the best they could. Speaking of ham radio operators, NASA, and this is like right down Jeff's alley right here, so I'm gonna infringe on him a little bit. That's what you get for not having a show tonight, Jeff. He's on vacation. That's fine. We'll hit him off the hook this time. NASA says, ham radio operators, we need your help during solar eclipses. Ham radio operators, we're calling you. Members of the Ham Radio Science Citizen Investigation will be making radio contacts during the 2023 and 2024 North American eclipses, probing the Earth's ionosphere. It will be a fun-friendly event with competitive element, and you're invited to participate. Both amateur and professional broadcasters have been sending and receiving radio signals around the Earth for over a century. Yeah, we know that. Such communication is possible due to interactions between our sun and the ionosphere, the ionized region of the Earth's atmosphere, located roughly 80 to 1,000 kilometers overhead. The upcoming eclipses, one's on October 14th, 2023, one's on April 8th, 2024, provide a unique opportunity to study these interactions as you and other ham SCI members transmit, receive, and record signals across the radio spectrum during the eclipse. You will create valuable data to test computer models of the ionosphere. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to see if we can map the ionosphere, we sort of have an idea what the ionosphere does. We know. And if those of you that don't know that the ionosphere is up there lurking about, During the day, the ionosphere is at its most prevalent. You've got D, E, and F1 and F2 regions. D is closest to the Earth, then E, then F1, then F2. As it becomes night, the lower two layers dissipate. And then the F1 layer goes up into the F2 layer to form one layer. This is what your radio waves bounce off of and come back down to Earth when you're running long, you know, shortwave frequencies, longer waves, longer wavelengths. You're basically bouncing them off of these higher altitude ionosphere layers and back down into the ground. This is why at 10 o'clock at night, you can turn on a radio in Minnesota and hear 6:50 a.m. coming out of Nashville like it's a local station. It's not because they crank up the wattage. It's because the ionosphere dissipates and the signals are bouncing all over the place. Well, yeah, that station has a lot of wattage going on, and I think they actually crank it up at night. They're allowed to. Some stations are allowed to for the FCC. But if you're a ham radio operator, you know darn well there are certain frequencies that at night you can go all over the world with. That's just the way it is. So it sounds to me like what they're going to do is basically see if they can actually get a real definitive answer of just exactly how the ionosphere is affected by things like these eclipses. Should be some interesting stuff. That's Nerdfest stuff to the nth degree. I'm telling you right now, that's some pretty cool stuff. I can't wait for that. So there you have it. Don't have a heck of a lot else going on. Thank you so much. So much. And you know, we kind of really blew by the top of the hour last week. Jeff and I, we probably could have done 2 hours of what we were talking about, but just keep it in mind. You're seeing a lot of distractions. In all seriousness. Yeah, I was kidding about the whole Harry and Meghan thing. We're seeing a lot of things that are kind of distractions. The media, of course, you know, media does things. They get fixated on one hot button. Train derailments. Oh, train derailments. You know, they just pound it right into your head. Take your face and just shove it right into the, you know, train derailments every day. Well, they happen a lot. And they're going to happen more because we use trains a lot more than we used to back 20 years ago. And a lot of it's going to happen even more because, quite honestly, let's face it, people, we're dumbing ourselves down. The people running these operations now don't have nearly the experience and the intelligence that the people that used to run them have. That's statistical. We just ain't as smart as we used to be. The intentional dumbing down of the American people. It's not going to come to any good end. I can tell you that right now. But thank you so much. So much, guys in chat. Appreciate you hanging out with me tonight. Everybody, I appreciate it so much. Hanging out with me. Keep it locked on KLRN Radio. There's some important news coming up, hopefully in the next couple of weeks. Big news in KLRNville. We do have incriminating photos of our boss down at in New Orleans, in Nolens, at the Mardi Gras. And, you know, I'm going to put myself in for a raise to see if I can get it, you know, where he doesn't have that picture exposed several times over. No, I won't do that to you, Rick. I won't do that because I'm sure there's photos of me hanging out there. What do you got in there? They're showing a picture. Wonder what the NASA was picking up in Alaska. Oh, there's a NASA plane out there going through Alaska. Probably that science project they shot down. Everybody have a great night. Keep it locked on KLRN Radio. We'll be back next week with next weekend, Stacy Lennox will be joining me and playing in the dirt. And we should be having a lot of things to talk about there. Because spring is sprung. It's coming up. In fact, I got flowers growing on the outside of the house that makes me so excited, even though it's still February. Keep it locked here. We'll talk again soon. God bless.
There's lightning striking all over the world.